All right, guys, another episode of the Eccentric Podcast. I have the esteemed Khaled Rausch, my colleague in creating the Think Peace Podcast, which we help produce. 20 years of experience in USIP. You worked on the Justice and Security Dialogue, correct? Everything. So I'm very excited to get Khaled on here. And, you know, so I just want to start off, Khaled, could you tell us a little bit about yourself? What got you into this field? And, you know, you have a lot of experience in this field, being even working as a federal prosecutor and everything like that. So I kind of want to ask, like, what facilitated you getting into this field, well, into the field of peace building, from being in like the legal field and doing other things?
Sure. First of all, so great to be here with you, Cam. It's so cool. Like, usually we're talking about meetings and things, and now we're on your podcast. That's super cool. So what got me interested, I think, to start with, what got me interested in the justice field, when I thought about that, I think it really relates to my upbringing. So I had a really, you know, basic childhood growing up in Reno, Nevada, and everything was pretty normal. Yeah. And then around 8 is when everything shifted and kind of my world turned upside down. And when my parents divorced, my mom became a single mom, and she went through different relationships and marriages, and domestic violence was very prevalent in my life. And so there were a number of years there where we were needing to leave our home, move to motels a few times where we didn't have exactly a place to live, mm-hmm. a lot of exposure to the criminal justice system, police coming to the house. Yeah. And so I think really that's what made me get interested in the justice system. And I think it then made me look at the thing of, how do you prevent violence and how do you resolve conflict? So I started out with the justice system, as you mentioned, you know, working as a prosecutor and then later as a federal public defender, mm-hmm. in death penalty work, in the appeal stage, looking at, you know, what was the background of one of my clients that would show that, you know, despite having committed a crime, that really, given my client's background, that death was not an appropriate penalty. Yeah. And it was, a lot had to do with childhood abuse and a lot of challenges that they had growing up. So to me, it was really just this desire to figure out, how do we make peace? How do we prevent conflict? How do we prevent little kids like me from being in this position in the first place of being stuck in the middle of a domestic violence situation?
Awesome. So kind of going off that, so I know you have a lot of experience doing, you know, also things like international work. I know you worked international for a couple of years, and just even... And like, I know it's a lot of stark differences between like what it takes to build peace international and what it takes to build peace domestically. So I kind of wanted to ask you what facilitated you getting into the more domestic field of peace building as opposed to when you were working overseas and everything?
Yeah. So when I was working overseas, I started out working overseas when I first went to Bosnia on behalf of the Justice Department, where they were sending over prosecutors to go help in the post-conflict time period to help rebuild the justice system. And that was my first exposure, mm-hmm. to international work. And then when I came back, it really struck me. I remember coming back from Bosnia, mm-hmm. and I'd been there about a year. And I had learned about how, you know, this was the community where the Sarajevo Olympics took place.
Yeah.
This is a community, when I talked to so many of my friends and colleagues, talked about how they lived side by side for years. Yet, despite that, they ended up in a civil war, and there had been a genocide, mm-hmm. against Bosniaks. And I came back, and what they've talked about is how there were certain injustices or certain issues of the past that had not really been resolved within their community.
Yeah.
So when political leaders in the country and in other countries decided to take political control, they started to pick at the wounds of history, of the unresolved wounds of society, mm-hmm. and use those wounds to pick to divide people and to turn people against each other, neighbor against neighbor, even family. And so I remember coming back to my prosecutor's office in Las Vegas, Nevada, being really struck by this and saying to some of my fellow colleagues, you know, and this was, by the way, this was in 1999,
okay,
saying, you know, I'm concerned. I think that our country hasn't really dealt with its history. It hasn't dealt with its history of slavery and its history of what happened to our Native American community. Yeah. I had grown up in the West and my cousins were from the Paiute tribe. And okay. So I had heard about, you know, heard about their history. And I remember talking about that, saying, you know, I wonder if divisions could happen in our country because we haven't dealt with this.
Yeah.
History. So the seed was actually planted then, mm-hmm, about the US, but it wasn't really like full technicolor in my mind at that time. And I went back, and as you mentioned, I've been working, it's hard to, when you say 20 years, I'm like, oh my God.
It's okay, Gullet.
Yeah, thanks. It feels like five, right? So I think, wow, but all the time when I was overseas, I kept thinking in the back of my mind, two things. One, these are going to be really helpful skills,
yeah,
for the time when maybe in my own country, we're going to have a reckoning, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. And we're saying that now.
Yeah. Exactly. You know, it reminds me, years ago, I was working with, his name is Lord Alterdice, who had, yep, was a psychiatrist, and he was involved in Northern Ireland peace process. And he had said the past is in the present, meaning until we've addressed the past,
yeah,
it continues to plague us in the present.
Yeah. And so that's kind of like a good segue. Like, so I know you're also doing a USTRHT work, the US Truth, Racial Healing and Transformation stuff. So I kind of want to ask you, like, how are you using you did explain like how you learned from overseas and everything, but so kind of what facilitated you wanting to be a part of that movement and making sure that, you know, the things that you learned overseas, that we can apply those to America and just our racial history? And what are some of the things that y'all are doing now to, like, in this current time to kind of get that going?
Yeah, so I think the point was, as you were talking about, I looked at how it was not possible anymore to be working overseas to a certain extent, while that's important, when there were things that were needing to be done in my own country, and also to go overseas and be present and support, knowing that we don't have it all figured out here. Mm-hmm. So I always have this kind of dissonance of, what am I doing working overseas as a person with knowledge?
Yeah.
Here, we're here to help you when we need help ourselves. Mm-hmm. So it just felt a little, I don't know, a little bit of dissonance.
Yeah.
So being here, I think I gravitated towards working back in my own country so that I could be part of that. Mm-hmm. And it felt like, you know, what is it like, heal your own self and community.
Yeah, you have to heal your own community, but
yeah, exactly. And what is my role in that? And how do I work? So, yeah, so today was a pretty cool day.
Mm-hmm.
Today, the resolution was introduced. Representative Barbara Lee and Senator Cory Booker introduced a resolution with a number of supporters. Yeah, today, a resolution today. That was today.
Awesome.
It just super cool. And a number of co-sponsors from the House and the Senate. And it was to establish a U.S.-based truth, racial healing, and transformation society.
So, you said that was introduced to the House today.
Yeah, it was introduced today. So I was just before we got on, it's all over. There's a whole Twitter storm going on. So there's this whole Twitter storm going on. So it's pretty cool. And yeah, so it's hashtag unlock the truth on Twitter.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's going on right now. Oh, you know, can you see? I got to move my thing. The sun is coming in. I'm being anointed with light, yeah. That is blinding me. Okay, let me just move over. Okay.
All right, and so just kind of just also going off that. So I know you talked about the efforts that you see overseas and stuff. So why do you feel like, you know, reconciliation efforts in other places are more successful than they are in the U.S. Like from what you've seen in your work? Because I mean, I know that we, you know, a truth commission, obviously, like now it's more on the pipeline. Like, you know, there's a lot of work being done to do it. But why do you feel like it's so necessary now, and why has this not occurred before? And even in doing this work, why have we not seen results in the U.S.?
Yeah. The first thing I would say is it's always a work in progress anywhere. So even in the number of commissions that work around truth or healing or transformation or reconciliation, truth, reconciliation commissions, TRCs, or under the umbrella of what they call transitional justice. Mm-hmm. So transitional justice, broadly defined, is a set of mechanisms designed to address past abuses. Uh-huh. And to prevent them from continuing on. So overseas, you'll see lots of different mechanisms. It may in the toolbox of transitional justice, it may be having criminal prosecutions or accountability mechanisms. Uh-huh. It may be having testimony and truth commissions for victims to talk about what had occurred, to try to find a record and archiving of truth so that yeah. truth is not lost. It can be moralizations. Mm-hmm. Or it could be reparations. There's a whole different toolbox, all designed to get to how do we transform society? How do we heal? How do we fix what was wrong, so to speak, the structures or the drivers of the conflict or the injustice or wrongdoing? And so I think out of all the different commissions and the transitional justice mechanisms overseas, I would have to say none of them are perfect.
Yeah.
And none of them have truly been like quick, you know, with a check mark, success done.
Yeah, success, yeah.
Yeah, everybody.
Find success in this work too, honestly.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And just humans being humans, it's not so easy, you know, for everything to be put back in a way that creates, you know, peace across the board. So with the U.S. process, the architects of the resolution and the architects of a lot of the different commissions that you're starting to see come up around the country, mm-hmm. around different issues. Some in Maryland is an anti-lynching commission. There's other commissions that are looking at police and community relations. Mm-hmm. So commissions may have different goals, different objectives. And there are different objectives coming up around the country. What a lot of them have been looking at are experiences from overseas and mm-hmm. learning from those, the pros, the things that didn't work so well, things to avoid, things that worked. But truly, it has to be tailored for the community. And so a lot of the community-based ones are really needing to be designed around the community. This national one, which is what the resolution designed to look at, is looking at trying to create structures or approaches to have kind of a national approach.
Okay.
But then there's also, like I mentioned, critically important to have, you know, independent commissions at the local level to be, you know, very tailored to the needs of those communities.
Cool. So, and also you also, you know, study trauma and everything, and like you understand trauma, so you know and a lot of the base of this work comes from trauma, you know, like understanding it, and you know we've had a couple podcasts talking about trauma, so I kind of wanted to ask you, so do you feel like trauma affect, I mean, because you know in places like Bosnia and stuff, these are more like homogenous populations and stuff as opposed to being in the U.S. do you feel like the, because of that, you know, the way that the trauma is shared, is you're able to have more success, or like you're able to be more productive in your work because it is so homogenous as opposed to so much diversity in the U.S. Like, do you feel like that plays a part, the homogeneity? I don't know how to say the word, but because of homogeneous populations.
Yeah. So two things. One is, I got involved in working to understand trauma and working with it. is because I found that as important as it is to build justice systems, structures of justice, and even Dr. Gail Christopher, who's the architect of the process of moving, you know, from the harm to transformation and racial healing. The challenge that we often have is if we look at things only as technical, like passing a law, setting up a commission, or doing all these technical things, we're missing the human dimension.
Yep.
So what I've saw overseas and what's important as we move forward with the commissions or however it works through the systems in the US is that human beings are at the core of these commissions. Mm-hmm. It's human beings who suffered harm. It's the human beings that continue to suffer harm. And it's the human beings that will be able to come up together with the solutions to remedy that harm. And so that's why issues of trauma are so important to understand as we're doing these kind of structural type of technical commissions.
Awesome. And so also that kind of, and also, you know, you worked at USIP, the U.S. Institute of Peace, for those who don't know. And I know that you were on the Justice and Security Dialogue. So I wanted to ask, could you like explain a little bit about what that was for people so that they would know what it's about?
Sure. And this is perfect because it ties together the justice system with the trauma. Yep. So at the end of the war, the civil war in Nepal that had been going on for 10 years between the state and then the Maoists, there was a civil war, you know, just devastating. And what ended up happening, as you can imagine, after war, any conflict, the society was fractured and there was a lot of distrust, a lot of trauma, and a lot of division. Mm-hmm. And you mentioned earlier the issue of groups that are unified or one group. Mm-hmm. So in Nepal, there was a whole different mixture of groups. In a lot of the countries in which I worked, a lot of times there were issues of religion, of ethnic background, of class, all the different ways that we all divide ourselves as human beings and into groups and fight and have division. And so in Nepal, that had happened. Mm-hmm. And so what I could see, and just right before the war ended, talking to police and talking to human rights activists, you could hear that they had a common goal. And that was a system of justice for everybody and a way that they could work together. And so I worked with police and I worked with communities. The communities included, as mentioned, human rights activists, to journalists, to political actors. And we created together with them leading it and me simply providing support. Because sometimes it's helpful to have kind of an outside neutral party kind of be of support, but they were leading it, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Is we created a dialogue process where police and community came together in dialogue to talk about what the problems were, heard each other's stories, and work together to build trust and then to create solutions, because they were both suffering from lack of justice. Mm-hmm. Crime rates were increasing, insurgent groups were starting to come in. So it was in their benefit to work together. But in order to work together, the police had to acknowledge that what they were doing was not helpful to certain communities. And so they had to have honest dialogue and discussion and very hard conversations to address the roots of what the police were doing. And then they came together in that way. So that was a justice and security dialogue that then spread. We'd worked at a similar process in Iraq and Libya in different countries.
Awesome. I know, you know, this was focused in Nepal and Iraq, like you said. So do you feel like the things that you all talked about in that dialogue, do you think that could be applied to the U.S. or have there been efforts to duplicate what you guys did over there in the U.S. to improve police relations here domestically?
Yeah, no, I think a model like that could be adapted, and I think it has been in different communities. And I think when we talk about a model like that, I think what we see, and there are different endeavors all over the US with progressive type thinking or police departments who are willing to do this type of work, and community members who are wanting to partner. And it really, to me, is a set of principles. It's not like a cookie cutter type of process or anything that can be, you know, directly replicated, but it has certain principles. And one principle is there has to be an openness at the leadership, especially with the police, the leadership. And this is what we found to be true in Nepal and every country, but it's also because the hierarchy of a police organization, the leadership had to be on board and be willing to engage and to look at how they're operating and what they're doing and what could be done differently. And then to work in partnership with community members and to know, and this is where the trauma and the human dimension and nervous system comes into play. It's not going to be easy.
Yeah.
Because if we were just all operating intellectually, it'd be much easier. Yeah. Even just logical.
Exactly, that's not the case.
We're not. Because we come to these meetings or dialogues or discussions with our own background, our own history. And you know, when we look at history, we also look at, we see this in the US, but we also see in the countries in which I've worked, intergenerational trauma and intergenerational harm. And so if you look in the US historically from slavery, but in addition to slavery, but also just the difference in how people treat each other who are from different groups. It could be based upon skin color. It could be based upon religion. It could be based upon class. There's different ways that, like I mentioned, we kind of divvy up who's safe, who's not. And there's, as you know, done the podcast, there's, you know, neurobiological factors to that. But getting back to the dialogue, it's so critical that we understand that's what's happening.
Yeah.
And we're aware of our wiring. We're aware of our wounds. And so when we're communicating with people, we're not just operating at a logical, we're operating at an emotional, you know, neurobiological level and language too. So to the extent that we can work with that, hopefully slowly bring this to healing and to understanding.
Yeah. And also going off that, like a lot of people don't even realize that, you know, healing is such a non-linear thing. Like, you know what I'm saying? Especially, and especially when it comes to racial healing and everything, like, you know what I'm saying? I know, especially me as like a Black male seeing like, okay, yeah, you know, things might seem progressive and stuff. And then you see something like the events of January 6th, and then you're like, okay, now we haven't made any progress and stuff. So it's like, it's really important to, for people to understand that, because it's like, it's not just, things aren't just going to go as smoothly as you want it to be, which is why this work is so important. You know what I'm saying? So going off that, you know, we have our podcast and stuff that we've helped produce and everything, the Think Peace podcast. So I kind of wanted to ask you, what kind of made you want to create the let me start off asking this. What's the connection that you see between neuroscience and peace building for those that don't understand and that haven't listened to our podcast yet?
Yeah. So to me, they are so connected, they can't be separated.
Yeah.
So to me, you know, going back to your point of, you know, we think we're making progress, especially, you know, in certain areas, and then you see something that happens, and then you just get thrown back into feeling like, well, what's
the point? Feel like you're back to square one. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And it is so not linear. Mm-hmm. And I think until we all die, we will continue to struggle with those buttons getting pushed. So the reason I become so passionate about the podcast that we're doing is because I see how critical the neuroscience, the neurobiology, the human system is to anything we want to do in peace building or anything we want to do in healing, whether that's, you know, racial healing or healing along other divides in our country, political, because so much of our response to these things are based upon things that are tied with our neurobiology, the intergenerational trauma, the patterns of bias or things that are our reactions are from our experiences. So if we're not if we're not, like with the podcast that you and I are doing, if we're not bringing that to the consciousness and the education awareness, then we aren't going to, I feel that we're not going to be able to make the movement that we're going to need to on a personal level for healing within communities and within, you know, radiating out to the society.
Mm-hmm. And going off, you know, this idea of intergenerational trauma and stuff also, so I kind of wanted to ask you, what's the connection between what's the effect that intergenerational trauma can have on somebody's like neuroscience or their psychology, or that you have seen in the work that you've done over the years?
Yeah. So I think like how Dr. Ali Jawad, who we had on the podcast, talks about, I love how he described it, because there's certainly the human wiring part. There's certainly how certain trauma can get passed along the genome. I don't want to be too, because that's his area, but it's, you know, those that could get passed down through generations, which is so profound. But the really important thing also is how things show up or manifest in our behavior. A lot of it has to do with our environment and our experiences. And so I look at, like, for example, let's just use my family as an example. Since I grew up in a family where there was domestic violence and there was alcoholism, we could see that going back through generations. Yep. And the question could be, was this from, you know, passed along through genetics? And, you know, the epigenetic researchers would say to an extent it can be, but that doesn't mean it manifests and turns into it. Mm-hmm. It has a complex interplay with our environment.
Yep.
So how it gets into these cycles is then, you know, the person who grew up in it, if they then see it and then they replicate it, and that's where you get those cycles of domestic violence. Yep. Or they're raised a certain way where people yell at them or hit them. Yep. Well, that's what you're seeing. So then you replicate that. And so we do these patterns by what we're experiencing, what we're seeing, and then what gets passed along. But the beautiful thing that Dr. Jawad mentioned, which I, you know, think is the hope, is all is not doomed. That's why I'm so passionate about the healing aspect, because there's ways that we can put a stop on it, a pause button, by providing ways where we don't engage in replicating that. We provide support to children.
Yeah, we break people out of these cycles. And I mean, I know we definitely see that a lot in like a lot of like impoverished communities and stuff, like the way people grow up, you know, people grow up, even things like PTSD or something, like from seeing the things around you and everything. But it's like also just like how, like you were saying, like how people end up growing up, especially in like in these impoverished households, they don't really realize why their life might have turned out how it was, or like why their life is how it is. But it's like, when you really go back and look and see how somebody was raised, I mean, even the whole concept of epigenetics that Ali was talking about, it's like a lot of people, it's not something that people even understand or know about, which is why I think our podcast is so important, because it's like something like that can literally shape like how your life turns out. And it's like, and it's not even in your genetics, it's just how you were raised. And it's like, it has such a profound impact on you. It's really important. So I kind of want to ask you, what did you hope to gain from creating this podcast and this platform for, you know, talking about the intersection between the brain and peace building?
Yeah, for me, I was so interested in, one, getting the information out. Mm-hmm. And amplifying that information in a platform, thanks to you, you know, helping me figure out what the heck a podcast was and, you know, what it was. So that would be hopefully interesting, that people would think, that's interesting, and kind of maybe change some thinking.
Yeah.
Two was to amplify and to bring to into the, you know, community of people listening, people whose voices or areas that people may not have thought about.
Yeah.
And so I thought that to the extent that that could happen, then we might be able to have an experience, or that might resonate with people and they might think differently. Mm-hmm. And the third main point, obviously the uber goal, so to speak, is I remember one of my death row clients, my job was to really look into his history. And when I looked into his history, yes, he'd murdered somebody. Mm-hmm. And totally, you know, he understood and in his mind, it wasn't a question that he felt like he could get out of prison, because he felt that given the way his wiring was, that he didn't feel like he could safely engage.
Yeah.
But the question was, should he be put to death? Mm-hmm. You know, and of course I say no.
Yeah.
And looking at his background, there were so many times, even if he had had the so-called wiring of intergenerational, you know, the genome and that aspect, there were so many times in his life, it was heartbreaking, where if anybody had stepped in, you know, where how he was sent to a juvenile hall, how, you know, there were so many opportunities for the system, the police, the justice system, the welfare system, to have done something differently.
Yeah.
Just a slight twist
that
could have completely changed the course of his life and the victim's life who would be alive. I mean, this is how in my mind I kept thinking. I kept seeing doorways that he just kept getting shut down. And again, I'm not saying he didn't commit murder, but I'm saying, why do we even have to get to that point? So that's the other part, is I hope that we can get to a point where we can look at our institutions, our justice systems, and we can look at, instead of just blaming people as throwaway people, can we look at how many ways we can support people from childhood, especially in the early childhood, which Dr. Jawad would talk about, where we wouldn't be having these problems to begin with. And why is it my son won't have to worry about these doorways, because he grew up in a different neighborhood with a different code, with a different set of benefits? Like, why is that? Why can't we have that for all the kids?
Yeah. And that's a good anecdote, because I also have a kind of similar story. I have a friend who I grew up with. You know, he used to get in trouble and stuff. Like, you know, he had a good heart and everything, but it's like, I mean, obviously there were like when we really went back and look at it, it's like, it really probably was something that was going on with his brain. Like, I mean, I know he definitely used to have like things like ADHD, or like he was diagnosed with ADHD, and it's like, you know, you definitely see that, and it's like, it's tragic, because he actually ended up being murdered this like past September. But it's like, you know, he had been in and out of the juvenile system and things like that, and it's like, you really start to think back, like, you know, what if somebody could have helped him at this point in his life, before he even got to the point of, you know, where he was getting in trouble going to juvie and stuff. And it's like, you know, especially when you're stuck in a cycle like that, it's like, you know, you feel like you only have a couple choices, like, you know, and these choices often lead to either jail or death. And it's like, it's just sad seeing that's how something could end up. Cause I mean, he was 21 years old, just like me. And it's like, just seeing how that happened. And so, like, you talking about your story with the death row inmate, it's like, that really resonated with me, because it's like, you really do see that there are systems. I mean, these systems have failed certain people, but it's like, that didn't have to be the case if there was better understanding of why these things happen, or why these people act out how they do.
Exactly. And going to a situation where if I'm living in a certain environment, then I'm going to learn to survive. Yeah. And if to survive in that environment is I have to act a certain way, well, that's what I'm going to act. So can we perhaps maybe just create a different environment where people aren't having to be in, you know, only certain choices?
Yep.
You know, I don't know. It's just
and that also kind of goes with what Sabra was saying in the past event, when she was talking about just some of the inmates that she was working with. Like, she was just talking about like how prison, once you get to prison, it's like, it just becomes a matter of survival. You know what I'm saying? Even if you weren't a racist person before, like, you might join like the white brotherhood or something, because that's how you're going to protect yourself in these systems. And it's like, and you know, that even like we were saying, that goes even beyond just like jail and the whole prison system. It's like, when people are stuck in these cycles, when you're only seeing certain things, you're not getting the proper help that you need. I mean, I definitely know in places like Chicago and stuff, or like Baltimore, it's like, it's a lot of kids and stuff who are really growing up with PTSD, because they're seeing, like, you're seeing your friends and stuff get killed and stuff, but it's like, but you're not getting the proper help. And then it's like, you know, you just continue down the same path. I even saw an interview one time where it's like, a lot of like kids in these areas, it's like, they didn't even have a plan for after they turned 21, because they didn't expect to even live past that. And it's like, this is in our country, you know, the country that has the resources to help people. But it's like, we're not necessarily providing these, I mean, and even a lot of soldiers and stuff too, like, like, I mean, who have PTSD, you know, they come back and it's like, I know even in some of these cases with just people snap sometimes because they never really got the proper help. And it's like, you have these deep-seated traumas. I mean, especially people who have been in war and everything, you've seen some terrible things, and it's like, you never really got the proper guidance. And then it's like, people end up committing suicide or just do all this. And it's like, it could have easily been prevented if people really understood what was going on in the brain or why people felt how they felt.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And there becomes a stigma and a sense of shame or weakness because of these things. Instead of, it was a situation that people are put in, war and things like that. And the human body, and you know, I always kind of say, until our human system evolves, like, you know, computers in some way, you know, we're still left with wiring we've had, you know, that has not quite evolved to be able to just control, alt, delete these things. Yeah. Like it has to just be. And the thing you mentioned about kids, you know, I remember my a family member who has dyslexia and was fortunate enough in our school system to have support and recognition, so got put in a special program. And at the special program, it was a small program within a larger school. And when I went to visit, I could see all these other kids that were gravitating towards the kids that are in this program because they were they recognized him. But these kids didn't have families who could afford or understand that they had perhaps a learning disability too. And so these kids didn't get the special program or the advocacy. The schools were doing the best they could, but they didn't have the home and the families that could push for it. And so you could see the kids who had it were flourishing, and then the other kids didn't.
They were just left behind.
They were kind of left behind, and the schools are doing the best they could. And my question is, it's not necessarily on the schools. It's on, like, where can we as society, you know, value and lift up those kids? And then the studies show that a lot of the kids who have learning disabilities end up later having perhaps, you know, it could be acting out of frustration. And then they're automatically deemed as troublemakers, especially if they're children of color. And then it just, like, puts them on this track into a system. And it's just like, you could see it and you're like, how can we just stop and get the kids the support they need? And they would be so frustrated, you know?
And even going off that, I remember, have you ever seen the documentary 13th on Netflix?
No.
It's a really good documentary. It's by it was produced by Ava DuVernay. She's like a pretty prominent woman director, but she it basically just talked about, like, just the whole prison industrial system and stuff. But one of the key things that you kind of just said was, like, you know, kids are young and they act out. And so actually, I mean, you know about the private prison system and everything, but they actually decided how many prisons they would build. I mean, they would build based off of like second or third graders, like, who were acting out and stuff. And then they determined that's like, and it's like, it, you see, like, how this pipe, I mean, how it creates this school to prison pipeline. And I mean, because it's like, it's literally, you're basing the actions of second graders and third graders, you know, who might not even, who you don't know if they're coming from dysfunctional families or, you know, and it's like, you're preparing for them to be in this system. And then it's like, you know, say they end up do getting caught up in this system, you already built the prison and it's like, you have to fill it. And then, so it's like, and that's how a lot of people get caught up in this system and everything, honestly.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And when you're mentioning, you know, the goal of the podcast, and I really hope, I know it's just one small little effort, but to help people who may not know, because so much of it isn't that people are trying to be mean or trying to do certain things. It's they don't know. And so can awareness be brought so that people are like, God, I didn't realize that, because I do things and I cause challenges or harm. And when it's brought to my attention, I would hope I'd be like, oh, now I see, you know, but can we raise awareness so that people can do better?
Yep. And so just kind of closing out, I kind of wanted to ask you, let me ask you two questions. Where do you feel like your work has been the most substantive? And two, what does success look like to you in this work? Like, what, I mean, I know we both agreed that you know, success is obviously open for interpretation and stuff, but I want to know, what was your interpretation of success when it comes to the work in this?
Most substantive. I think they're kind of joined. I would think the most substantive and where I feel how I would define success. And how I've defined success is, let me say how I won't define it. I think when I was younger and a little bit more naive, I would have defined it as peace in the world. Or when I was a prosecutor, prosecuting elderly fraud, where elderly people were being, taken of their life savings.
Yep.
I thought, oh, I'll just get rid of all of the elderly fraud in Las Vegas, Nevada. Yeah. Yes, I thought that. I mean, but now that I am older and wiser, success to me really is on a one-to-one basis. Mm-hmm. One is, am I, it's creating relationships and things that can have transformation even within a couple people. So even when I was a prosecutor, something as small as working with an FBI agent to do a really good, fair, honest, well-written search warrant, where we could always go in front of the judge and hand over heart, we were doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. That's success.
Yep.
And then fast forward, it was, working in Nepal one-on-one and growing close with the families of the human rights activists or the police and seeing those relationships transform and me learning from them and them learning from me and all of us learning from each other.
Yeah.
It's really those moments that I enjoy most. Mm-hmm. Because I really do believe in the power. Even though it may not seem like, one person can make a difference, mm-hmm. I truly believe a person can, and how they are and how they engage with people. Because then those two people relate. And going back to epigenetics, mm-hmm. we can really help change cycles mm-hmm. by how we are showing up in the world, how we are working with people around us.
Yeah. Thank you for that. And so just kind of closing out, was there anything that you wanted to plug at the end, things that you're working on, or besides the Think Feast podcast, where peace crosses the mind, everyone should go subscribe to that. but things you're working on, maybe if you're writing something, or anything like that.
No, just Think Peace podcast, where peace crosses the mind. And then the other thing is, soon, related to that, with the Mary Hoke Center for Reconciliation and the Carter School at George Mason University, the manuscript that I've been working on with a number of my colleagues who've been on the podcast, neuroscientists and peace builders, we're turning that manuscript into a 3-part series called Neuropeace.
Yep.
So, you helped look at the cover and help us decide. So that is going to be the next thing. So we hope to have the first issue out in March. Okay. Neuropeace.org.
Awesome. All right. Thank you, Colette, so much for joining me on this episode of the Eccentric Podcast. And we will be in contact soon.
Yeah.